mind, let's all stand. We'll sing.
Christ the Lord is risen today.
So happy you could come help us celebrate today. And we want this to be a celebration. It should be a celebration that the Christ is risen. And really, what are we celebrating? Really? I mean, there is the God of the universe died for us, sinners. And he is alive, right? That's a big key. He's alive. And this is the power over death. We have death has no power over us. We can celebrate with him. And so glad you could be here. I want to celebrate like an army of the holies of the heavens should celebrate. We want to sing loud. We want to celebrate his death and resurrection today. Let me pray. Lord, we just thank you for this time that we can remember what you've done. We thank you that you had victory over death, that you rose. We thank you that you loved us so much that even while we were sinners, you died for us. And we want to celebrate, Lord. And if anyone's here that doesn't know you, that hasn't felt that forgiveness and knows that he will be or he, she will be with you forever, Lord, I just pray this is the day. Because we know this is the day that you have made. We have made it all true. And we celebrate this morning with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving ceases. My all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who risers high to final breath. Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of men can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand.
Let's hear it now.
No power of hell, no scheme of men.
Well, good morning. What a day, huh? The King lives. Amen. Amen, amen. He lives. What an interesting faith that we have as Christians, right? We celebrate a day when our Savior set aside his godness and came down and walked among us, endured a cross with which he had no guilt of his own, died a criminal's death for rebels, right? For rebels, not for people who loved him and that were worth something, but for rebels. And he endured the cross and scorned its shame. And then 3 days later, rose again. Think about that. That's pretty wild. And it's very true. And he's still in the business of changing lives. And what a hope we have because we serve a risen Savior, not one that's dead, not just a good moral teacher, but God, our King. As Paul says in 1 Corinthians, that great section, if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did, not raise, if that is true, and that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you're still in your sins. And those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people to be pitied. But, in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. And it's only in that promise that we can say along with Paul later on, when the perishable puts on the imperishable and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law, but thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Father in heaven, we thank you for the beauty of this day, for all that it entails, that you did, in fact, conquer death. Lord, as we reflected last Friday on the death of our Savior, paying the penalty for our sin, in somber reality and just reflection, Lord, today we celebrate with song and with rejoicing that you live. And one day, those of us that are in you will see you again. Thank you for the promise. Thank you for the eternal perspective. Thanks for being a living God. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I had a couple announcements here as we continue on in this celebration. I don't want you to miss. As you came in, you should have received a bulletin. There's some things in there you want to take a look at. But two things I want to highlight. One, something new we're doing this summer. And I know you're probably thinking, well, why are you making an announcement now? Because it's April, and before we know it, it'll be June, right? And so some of you have caught wind that we are going to do a vacation Bible school for the kids under the direction of our children's ministry leader, Lauren Bowman. There's some exciting stuff coming up in June, and some of you have already offered to volunteer and want to get on the wagon of help on that. And it's an opportunity to serve our BBF family here, and with the growing delegation of children, we want to offer something there. So write it down or be aware. I just want you to know that it will be this summer, June 19th through the 23rd, okay? And we're going to run 9 to noon here at the church. It's for kids ages 4 through 6th grade, roughly, okay? So younger kids. Registration is open on our website. You can go check it out right now if you want, and you can register and say, get my kid in there right away. It's for that brief week. If you're interested in helping, that's the other area. If you're interested in helping, we need help. So you can jump in on that. If you have children younger than four and you still want to help, hey, we'll take you, all right? So we're planning to staff a nursery and do everything we can to come alongside families that have situations where it's sort of like, you know, I've got kids younger and older, so we want to help. We're going to staff a nursery. We could use help in that. We could use help with the event all around. So if you're interested in knowing more, you can contact Lauren Bowman. If you don't know who Lauren Bowman is, come ask me, and I'll direct traffic. I'm happy to do that, okay? Again, June 19th through the 23rd, 9 to noon, Vacation Bible School, 4 years to sixth grade. We've got one other important announcement. It's timely. I'm going to have Martin come on up and share it, and we'll continue on.
As you're studying the Bible, you're going to see God speaking to men through other men. And here's some examples. Aaron was provided by God to walk beside Moses when Moses felt inadequate for the task. And Nathan was provided to challenge David when David went off the rails. And Barnabas was provided to encourage a disheartened Paul who had isolated himself in his hometown. And God is doing the same thing today. Recently, a friend of mine asked me a simple question. What changed that you find yourself in this predicament? And God's Spirit took that question and ran with it, opening my eyes to a problem that needed attention. I'm telling you all this today because it's the last call to sign up for men's retreat. Names get handed over to the chefs in 5 days. So on Friday, no food if you sign up after Friday. So we need to know if you're going to show up. A few weeks ago, Brett told the story about his brother who is having heart surgery. And he said, you know, the operating room was set, the doctors were ready, and they'd done the diagnosis, but his brother still needed to show up. And in the same way, with this retreat, we've got the stage set. This retreat has been prayed for. We're ready, and the Spirit's ready to speak through your heart, but you've got to show up. And this retreat, it's not only about what you might receive if you go to the retreat, but how you also might give. To the old men out there who are on the fence, maybe you're worn down by the years, God has given you wisdom by your many trips that you've made around the sun. And this retreat is a chance to build bridges with younger men. Share some of that wisdom. And you might find the enthusiasm of the younger men rubbing off on you. It's contagious. And young men, you're filled with life. Young men. But little life experience. And God has given you enthusiasm to share if you slow down enough to build bridges with older men. Let your enthusiasm for God and life rub off on the older men. And you may find their wisdom sharpening you. So this is it. Last call. Take advantage of the men's retreat. Sign up and show up.
Thanks, Martin. Some of you know we've tried to set the announcement and everything. This is a special occasion, Resurrection Sunday, so there's no children's ministry downstairs. There is you're welcome to go down to the cry room. I believe we have a nursery that if you want to head down to it, you can jump in there. But other than that, we're all together, and that's a good thing. So I'm going to pray one more time, and we're going to continue on singing songs of praise to our risen Savior. Father, again, we come before you this morning with great gratitude and thankfulness that you've conquered death and that you've given us a reason for the hope that lies within us. You are the reason for the hope that lies within us. We pray that this day would be extra special in our hearts and our minds, that you would fill us with your Spirit, speak through these songs, through Lauren's message this morning, and through our interactions. Be glorified in all of it, Father, we pray, as we make this day about you as it should be. In Christ's name, amen.
All right, let's stand up. Let's show these kids how we sing up here. The adults sing. The real men sing loud, right? So we sang this song on Friday. We're going to sing it again tonight. But if you recognize this song, you recognize the fact that we left out a verse. We didn't think it was appropriate to sing, "See the stone is rolled away, behold the empty tomb. Hallelujah, God be praised, he's risen from the grave." So we're going to sing those today.
I can see.
I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home, and day by day I know he will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, all the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God.
His name forever.
we thank you that you are the Alpha and Omega. You are the Lamb and the Lion, Lord. We thank you that you conquered death. We thank you that you are returning home. We thank you that the victory is won. We thank you for eternal life with you. We just celebrate you this morning. We thank you for your hope we have in you. We just pray you continue our worship with Lauren. Just speak through him. Lord, help us to continue the celebration. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning. This morning we're going to be serving John chapter 20, but by way of introduction, let me begin at the end of the chapter. So the end of John chapter 20 has this statement, which I think you could consider a purpose statement. This is how it reads at the end of John chapter 20. It says, "Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." So the Bible, you know, does have lots of information, but it is not a book that was written so that you may have knowledge. The Bible does have theology, but it is not primarily written so that you could have sound theology. It is a book that has moral instruction, but it isn't a book written so that you could live a moral life. If you had to pick one purpose, it would be this, what we see here. It is written that you might believe in Jesus and that you might have life. So what exactly did the author, John, here write? Well, what he did is he wrote an eyewitness account of Jesus of Nazareth, and one that we should consider carefully. He selected certain events. He calls them signs and certain things that Jesus did and said, and certain signs of who Jesus was. Last week we read in John chapter 19 about the crucifixion in that chapter, and the crucifixion, of course, is very important. But if the story of Jesus ended there and ended in John chapter 19, then Jesus would be simply a martyr. And what is a martyr? You know, a martyr is somebody who suffers or dies for what they believe, who then, after their death, serve as an inspiration to others. And history is full of martyrs. We have lots of martyrs even today. And these stories of martyrs have value. But there is much, much more to the story of Jesus. He's not a mere martyr. Because the crucifixion back in John chapter 19 was not the climax of the story. It wasn't the end of the story. The crucifixion does not stand alone. It is important because Jesus was executed and he was buried. And those events are very sad and very dramatic, but also at the time, under the Romans, they were also very common. So now we come to John chapter 20, and in John chapter 20, something extraordinary, something unbelievable is going to happen. Something that the disciples themselves don't really even have a category for. Something completely unexpected. And so the rest of the story begins this way. Let's get back to the first part of John chapter 20. The beginning of the chapter starts this way. It says, "Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb." And what transpires in this chapter changes everything, and it's going to give a whole new meaning and purpose to that crucifixion we talked about last week, and a whole new meaning and purpose to our lives today, all because of what happened on this early Sunday morning about 2,000 years ago. So let's begin in prayer before we dive into the text. So Father in heaven, you are the creator of all things, and you are also the author of history. And your story, the story that you wrote, has one pivotal character and one key event, and that's what we celebrate this morning. So may your Holy Spirit be with us as we read your word. Amen. So this morning we're not going to read all of chapter 20. We'll focus, we'll just a survey of it, and we're going to focus on the people, kind of like we did last week. The key people and what they see and experience. So this is how it starts out in John chapter 20. "Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, 'They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him.' So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going towards the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. So the writer here, John, you know, he speaks himself in the third person. He calls himself the one whom Jesus loved, and he's previously referred himself that way. And, you know, he's got to love this detail that John has to point out that he's faster than Peter, right? He arrives first. But the reality is he doesn't arrive first. Mary Magdalene was there before him, right? And Mary is actually with a group of women, and they arrive early. They see the tomb, and they relay the news. So let's back up a second. What did Mary see? Well, she saw a tomb, and tombs, in the, fancy tombs anyway, were hollowed out of a kind of like a cave, sealed with a round stone door and that's rolled across the entrance. And she sees that this stone has been moved, and this is not only strange, it's very upsetting to think that something has happened to Jesus' body. So she tells them, Peter and John arrive. So continuing on in verse 5, and stooping to look, he, John, saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying there, and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. Well, I sure love John, and again, a second time he mentions that he arrived first. But you have to love Peter's personality, you know, too. You know, through the Gospels, you know, Peter never hesitates. You know, when Jesus, he sees Jesus out on the water, and Peter's in the boat, he jumps right in, out of that boat, right? And at Jesus' arrest, Peter is the one who draws his sword and starts swinging. So Peter doesn't really think twice. John hesitates. I mean, this is a tomb after all, but Peter goes right in. And what do these guys see? John and Peter see the same thing. And there's something a little bit subtle in the text. It says that they saw. They saw. It says it three times in this one paragraph. In the English translations, this is the same word. In the Greek, it's actually three totally different words for see. You could say he viewed, he glimpsed, he observed. And it's not so much that there's a subtle theological difference between these words. I mean, there's not some nuance we're interested in at this point. They all mean the same thing. They all mean he saw. It's a simple word. But what's more important than the word saw is the more important than that verb is the object. What did they see? So John sees. What did he see? The linen cloth. Peter sees. What does he see? The linen cloth. Then verse 8, John comes into the tomb and it says that he sees. What does he see? It doesn't say. It doesn't say specifically. I remember teaching 8th grade algebra, and so there's a whiteboard, and I would write something on the board, and I would learn to adjust my position and not write like this, but write from the side so that students could see what I wrote, you know, because I needed them to see. But even more significant than that, than them seeing, is when a student was working on something and struggling a bit, and they say, oh, I see. Because as important it is to see optically, to see with your eyes, it's more important to understand, to connect the dots, to grasp the meaning. And for a student, it's often visible on their face. You know, it clicks, and sometimes I think that click is almost audible. You can hear it, right? So what did Peter and John see? Well, they saw the linen clothes first, and then it says John saw and he believed. And I think this is more than optical. I think he's putting it together. He's connecting the dots. And John can write about this because this is his own account of when, the exact moment, he put it together. And as simple as it is, as simple as this statement is, I think this is the climax of John's personal account. He believed. Now, what did he believe? It doesn't specifically say, but the context would indicate he believed that Jesus had risen from the dead. And note that he hasn't actually seen Jesus yet, right? He's just seen some cloths and an empty tomb. Now, there's a parenthetical note at this last the last part here in verse 9. It says, for prior to this, and it's probably referring to the disciples as a whole, they hadn't understood that Jesus must rise from the dead. And this is despite the fact that Jesus himself had spoken about the resurrection and said that he would die and be raised again. And so how did they miss it? How did they not put this together? Well, the Old Testament has this theme of resurrection all through it, but the Jews typically applied it to the nation of Israel. You know, God would bring Israel back. So resurrection, the concept wasn't so much thought of as individuals, it was thought of as a metaphor for the whole nation of Israel being restored. And so when Jesus was arrested and crucified, the disciples are distraught. They aren't sitting around going, oh boy, I can't wait for 3 days. Can't wait till Sunday morning, we'll see what happens. They're not doing that. But I think at this very moment, John puts it together and it clicks. You can almost hear it. He sees and he believes. The disciples as a whole had not connected the dots, but now John, I think, may be the first. So let's skip down a little bit in this chapter and look at a second event. You know, the disciples go back after these developments, but Mary returns to the tomb and she's crying. And it had to be disturbing to find a tomb disturbed and the body gone. And she assumes it's grave robbers. So let's pick it up in verse 14. She, Mary, turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. So Jesus asked her a question, and she sees him again with her eyes. Optically, she sees him, but it doesn't click. She doesn't comprehend. And it could be different reasons for this. And I think maybe she's just distracted by her sorrows. There's tears in her eyes. And she simply doesn't realize that it's Jesus. And remember, she's not looking for a risen Lord. She's looking for a corpse, right? She's confused. She sees a man, and she assumes he's the caretaker. So what does Jesus do? He calls to her by name. He says, "Mary." And that's all it took. In this case, it wasn't seeing him. I mean, for whatever reason, tears or whatever, she doesn't see him, but she hears this one word from her Lord, a single word, "Mary." And it clicks. And she turns and grabs him, the text says, as if, you know, "I'm not going to let you go." And her sadness turns to joy. And there may be an analogy in the way of application that we can kind of see here. I mean, in our sorrow, we've all experienced great sorrow. Have you ever wondered, you know, where is God? It's easy to kind of miss him in our despair. But Jesus said, he says in this gospel, "You'll never leave nor forsake us." He says in the end of Matthew, he says, "I am with you always, even to the end of the age." But it doesn't mean we always see him. We just finished up the book of Esther leading up to Easter here. And this speaks to this theme of seeing God during tough times. And Mary hears her name. Verse 18, a little bit more about Mary. Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that he had said these things to her. On the evening of that day, that would be Sunday, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." And when he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Well, is seeing believing? You know, it's maybe hard to say in today's world of deep fakes and Photoshop and everything else. But in this case, seeing certainly helped. I mean, this isn't some kind of group hallucination. These people weren't idiots. I mean, this had to be very dramatic and convincing. Jesus comes among them suddenly and it says, "Peace." In other words, don't be afraid. And emotions go from grief and fear, we see, to peace and gladness. And just in a few weeks, as later recorded in Acts chapter 3 and 4, this is going to be these disciples who are afraid before are going to be infused with boldness. How do we account for this change? It's because they saw the Lord. Now, there's one more part to this story. Jesus appears to the disciples, but not all the disciples were there. Verse 24. Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see his hand, see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." Now Thomas is a bit of a skeptic, to say the least. He doubts. It says here he's a twin, and in a spiritual sense, you know, maybe some of us are his twin. You know, maybe we doubt too. I think there's a lot of reasons to doubt God, and to go over all those reasons might be a separate sermon. But here, in this case, I think Thomas's doubt is actually with a good reason. I mean, consider, he's a disciple. He's a devoted follower of Jesus for years, but here Jesus was killed. And these crazy people tell him that, no, actually he's alive. In other words, I think Thomas's doubt is reasonable and understandable and rational because he has experienced the worst sort of a religious letdown. The man that he believed to be the Messiah is dead. And thus, he asks the other disciples for the strongest possible evidence. He says, unless I see him with my own eyes. And I don't want any trickery, I'm sure he's thinking. I don't want someone that looks like Jesus. I mean, I'm going to know him. I'm going to know him. I'm going to touch him. He says, I'm not going to be convinced any other way. Pretty strong statement, but understandable. Let's read on in verse 26. In verse 26, it says, 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here. See my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. Now, there's an eight-day gap here, and we don't know exactly what happened during that gap. I can guess it's a little awkward between Thomas and the other disciples, right? It certainly gave everyone a chance to ponder and think, and maybe Thomas himself just needs a little time to percolate here. We don't know. But after 8 days, Jesus shows up again, and when he does, he doesn't scold Thomas. And it says that Thomas sees. And I think he sees in the full sense of the word. You know, see my hands, yes, but you can almost hear that audible click, right? He gets it. And his response is so quick and intense. He says, my Lord and my God. My Lord and my God. I'll never forget one time I was talking with some Jehovah's Witnesses who came to my door. And Jehovah's Witnesses believe in a very different sort of Jesus than I'm preaching to you this morning. In particular, a Jesus who is not God. And I asked them specifically about this passage, and I asked them from their Bible, let's take a look, because this is a very strong statement about not only the reality of the resurrection, but also a strong statement about who Jesus is. Thomas declares, my Lord and my God, because, when Thomas declares this, I mean, it highlights what we said earlier, I mean, Jesus is not just a martyr. He's not a teacher or a rabbi. He was those things, but he's so much more. Jesus is God become flesh, God here on earth. And Thomas here, I think, has a great confession of faith, kind of on the fly, spur of the moment. So how did this polite gentleman at my door answer when I asked him about this passage? He said, well, it's one of two possibilities. He said, well, maybe Thomas was mistaken. Or maybe Thomas said, my Lord and my God, addressing two different people. Wow, well, what do I say? I mean, it's one thing to extrapolate a little bit and to connect the dots. It's another to connect dots that just aren't there because you feel like you've got to make the text fit your own ideas. Thomas, make no mistake about it, just called Jesus God, and what's awkward is that Jesus fully accepts it, which is completely blasphemous in a Jewish culture unless it were true. And this incident, we could look at the Gospel of John, but any of the Gospels, Gospel of John is a good example. This incident is one of many where Jesus makes similar claims. I mean, on 9 separate occasions, Jesus accepts worship, and he never rebukes anyone for it. Jesus told his disciples to pray to him. Jesus even forgave sins. In John chapter 8, Jesus claimed to be the great I am, the Yahweh, which is the divine title. In John chapter 10, Jesus claimed to be one with God. So you add all this up, you go, oh boy, only God is worthy of worship. Only God can hear our prayers. Only God can forgive sins. And all of these things about Jesus culminate in this Easter remembrance. You know, only God can die for the sins of another. It was not just some martyr dying on a cross for inspiration. Only God can do that. Only God can raise himself from the dead. And only God can give new life and new hope to us. Well, we're almost done, but there's one more character in the text this morning. We talked about Peter, Mary and Peter and John, and then Mary again, and then Thomas. Well, Jesus continues saying this to Thomas in verse 29. Jesus said to him, have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed. And then in verse 30, this is back where we began at the beginning of the sermon this morning. Verse 30, now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. So we have Thomas, but there's one more character, and that character is us. It's you and I. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed. You know, the women in this story saw that the stone had been rolled away, and John and Peter saw the empty tomb. And Mary then was the first to see the risen Lord in the garden, and then the disciples later saw these nailed, scarred hands. And you and I have seen nothing, none of those things. But as Paul says in 2 Corinthians, we walk by faith, not by sight. You don't have to see with your own eyes to see. Because John saw, yes, but more importantly, he remembered what was promised. He connected the dots, and John's confusion turned into understanding. But it's not like this is a mere academic exercise, because it's very personal. And like Mary, Jesus, I think, is calling your name. He's calling my name. Our grief can turn into joy. And if we take Thomas, you know, this poor guy, you know, Doubting Thomas, that's our nickname for him. Poor guy. Jesus never calls him that. That's our nickname for him. Because for Thomas, this doubt is temporary. It's part of the journey. And his doubt turns into belief. So these characters this morning all saw it, but it wasn't so much about seeing with their eyes. I mean, there's an element of that. But Jesus says, blessed are those who do not see yet believe. And that's the invitation to all of us this morning, that we may believe. Believe what? Well, I don't think it's believe that God exists, because the Bible says that even demons believe in God and they shudder. I don't think it's that we should believe that Jesus existed, although he did exist, but most atheists believe that much. I don't even think that we need to just believe that Jesus was crucified. I mean, that is true and is important, but it's not unique. He wasn't a mere martyr. And I don't even think that we should that the key is to believe that the tomb was empty. You know, it was empty. That's important, but there's lots of explanations for an empty tomb. Mary was looking around for someone who stole the body. So what are we supposed to believe here when John says, these things are written that you may believe? Well, I think what he continues to say here, he says, these things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. God himself became flesh and dwelt among us. He is the way, the truth, and life. That this Jesus is the Christ, which means Messiah. And as such, he rose from the dead, conquering sin and death. And our response, as with Thomas, is belief and worship. My Lord and my God. So I don't think we have to see everything with our own eyes, in an optical sense of seeing, but we have the words of God, and we need to see to believe. So we're going to pray this morning, and we'll sing a closing song. Almighty God, we do need to see. Your word says faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the convictions of things not seen. So we ask for your conviction. May your spirit convict us so that we put our trust in you. Praise things in your name. Amen.
All right, let's stand. One last song. is Jesus Christ. This is how Paul writes it in Colossians. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. Amen. Celebrate. Continue to celebrate with us. I believe back there, there are some donuts if all went well during this time. So have a great day. Have a great week. God bless you guys.